tension mounts in the locker room. They've not played the Dolphins in the Orange Bowl in 13 years. The Dolphins, the favorite. They always are on the home field at Miami, and Dan Marino, their excellent quarterback, is the big reason why. Both these teams trained to a fine edge for this most important game. Now to Bob Costas at NFL 85.
All right, Don, thanks very much. You bet the Dolphins are the favorites by 10.5 points. They haven't lost a game all year in the Orange Bowl. The Browns, with their 8-8 record as the champions of the AFC Central, the worst record ever for a playoff qualifier in a full season. The Dolphins, meanwhile, on a roll, winners of 7 in a row, finishing up the regular season at 12-4. Few people accord the Browns a chance, and now as we go to the Orange Bowl to join Ahmad Rashad. Ahmad, I understand that the Browns have suffered a setback even before they kick off.
They really have, Bob. They just found out today that Tom Cousineau has a broken wrist, and they haven't been able to find a cast to fit it, so his place will be taken by Scott Nicholas. It's unlikely that he'll play, so that's a big setback for the Cleveland Browns. But, you know, 2 weeks ago I said that Cleveland had to win the game against the Jets so they could get some momentum coming into this playoffs. It really didn't have anything to do with their season record, but they wanted to win so they could roll into the playoffs. They didn't, so today will be like starting all over. You take the Miami Dolphins, though, they've won the last 7 weeks in a row. They've had 2 weeks to lay off, and they will roll into these playoffs. Now, talking about some matchups, let's take a look at Bob Golic, the Pro Bowl nose tackle for the Cleveland Browns. He'll be going against Dwight Stevenson today, but he is one of the best nose tackles in the game, and what he relies on is just brute strength and his wrestling ability, his wrestling background. He likes to get in and create a lot of havoc in there and just destroy the timing of your offense. But the guy he's going against is a guy named Dwight Stevenson, who's the best center in the business. I talked to Stevenson about Golic. He said it's going to be a challenge for him, but what Stevenson does best, he has great quickness, and what he's able to do is he's able to maintain leverage on the nose tackle. Golic said he watched him in film all week, and there was a couple times that he was able to pick up the refrigerator and just sling him down like a sack of beans. He hopes that doesn't happen to him today. Another major matchup is going to be that of the Miami Dolphins tight ends. You hear a lot about Mark Duper and Mark Clayton, but let's take a look here at Dan Johnson, who is what they do is they create double coverage on the outside guys with Mark Duper and Clayton, which always sets a situation up on the tight end that he's always going man-to-man on either a linebacker or a strong safety. Here you see Dan Johnson catching a ball and going the distance here because he can flat-out run. Another situation, when they get down on Bruce Hart, I'm sorry, when they get down on the goal line, they have a situation where the Dolphins like to go to the wide receivers. When they put too much pressure on the wide receivers, they can go to Bruce Hardy. Bob?
Well, when you talk about tight ends, what about Ozzie Newsome of the Browns? Maybe the game's best, Ahmad.
Well, I talked to Don McNeil before the game, and he said that what they'll be doing is they'll put extra pressure on him in third down situations. But the thing that the Browns have been doing to try to free up Ozzie is on third down and long. They've been running the ball as of late. Today, they've got to go to Ozzie if they expect to do anything against the Dolphins.
They also obviously feel their ground game with Mack and Biner has to work both to move the ball and to eat up the clock and keep it away from Marino. Can they move it against Miami?
They will definitely move the ball against Miami because they have a ground attack that moves the ball against anybody. Where their problems come is if they get behind in the game, they really don't have a sophisticated passing attack to get back into the game quickly. That's where Miami has the advantage.
How good is Kozar right now, Ahmad?
Bobby, I think that he was a very heralded player coming out of college, but he is no more than a fine young quarterback, and he'll get better in years to come. And talking about this Dolphin team, at this level of football, the difference between winning and losing is in human error. What the Dolphins never do is they never make the mistake that beats them. They make you play your best. And if Cleveland doesn't play their best and go out and beat them, they'll have a tough time because Miami will not just hand you the football game.
All right, Ahmad, let's be direct. Do the Browns have any chance at all?
I think they have some chance. I think it's slim. I really think that it's going to come from they didn't beat the Jets. They have no role going into this game, and I have the feeling that they'll play extremely tough the first half, but when the game's all over, the Miami Dolphins, I think, are going to pull through here.
Okay, Ahmad, we'll check with you later. Another possible key to the game, the veteran wide receiver Nat Moore of the Dolphins, the subject of Pete Axthelm's feature later in the program. And we'll join Larry King live from Washington, D.C., when we continue on NFL 85, even though we realize it's 86.
NFL 85, the AFC playoffs, brought to you by the full line of 1986 Volkswagen.
This, ladies and gentlemen, is his video column of the air, and I understand you spoke with your friend Don Shula this week.
I did, Robert. I liked the title. I learned a long time ago the best way to get some knowledge is to ask questions of people with knowledge. And I talked to Don about today, and Don is very worried about overconfidence. He said, everybody is talking about us playing the Raiders. If we don't watch out and the Raiders don't watch out, the Browns will entertain the Patriots next Sunday in Cleveland. Don thinks the Browns are fully capable of playing great defense. They will try to control the ball this afternoon. He admits the Dolphins have been easy to run against this year, and he is, as all coaches, very worried. He said he would not be surprised if the Browns beat Miami today. Tomorrow, by the way, I'll give you Don's thoughts on the New England Raider game. You can forget those rumors that Monty Clark, the former Lion and 49er coach, is coming to the Eagles in an executive capacity. David Shula as coach, yes. But according to owner Norman Brayman, Clark, no. And Brayman told that to me personally. By the way, Don Shula also confirmed that Monty Clark is not going to Philadelphia. Tom Landry spoke with him last week about his thoughts on the Giants. He says he's emotionally involved. He will always root for the Giants unless they're playing the Cowboys. Landry said once a Giant, always a Giant. Dan Reeves, the Bronco coach, thinks that everybody has a chance to be in the finals except the Cowboys and Browns. Joe Namath told me that he loves the Cowboys over the Rams today and also gives the Giants a big shot tomorrow. Joe Gibbs also gives the Giants a big shot tomorrow. And I've been a sports fan all my life, Robert. I got lots of friends who are sports fans. None of them I have ever known ever read those year-end sports reviews in magazines and newspapers. We don't read them because we already know what happened. Robert?
An excellent point there, one I'd never pondered. But now let's go back to Don Shula and David Shula. What does the veteran coach say about his son's age, 26, the possibility of taking over an NFL team?
You know, it's amazing, Bob, but I know Don very well and spoke to him just the other day, and he said that David Shula is fully capable of being a head coach, and that when he was asked by Norman Brayman, I haven't seen Don quoted on this in the papers, when he was asked, he treated it as if he were asked about any assistant, and he would always give a correct evaluation when discussing an assistant. And what he said was, David Shula is fully capable at age 26 of running an NFL team.
Now, Larry, Don tells you he would not be surprised if the Browns beat his Dolphins today. He didn't say he wouldn't be angry. Would you like to be the guy to interview him immediately after a loss to the 8-8 Browns?
The answer is no.
And the final statement is goodbye.
Goodbye.
We'll continue with a feature on Bernie Kosar, who returns to the scene of collegiate glory with the Cleveland Browns today at the Orange Bowl when NFL 85... and Dolphins prepare to go at it at the Orange Bowl. You know, in a sense, this has been a double homecoming season for the Browns rookie quarterback Bernie Kosar. He hails from Youngstown, Ohio, and he was one of the few professional athletes in recent years to publicly proclaim that he wanted to play in Cleveland. But in a collegiate sense, Miami is his hometown. That's where, although he started but 25 games in his brief career with the Hurricanes, he became a local legend. And now, for his first ever NFL playoff game, he returns to the scene of his crowning collegiate achievement.
Bernie Kosar, a 6'5" freshman quarterback, directing the Miami offense, but he plays like a veteran. And he comes out of firing. Wide open is Stanley Shakespeare. He's down to the 34-yard line. Kosar with a quick drop. Guns the ball. Shakespeare's open. He's down to the 2-yard line. Kosar takes a look. He throws to Dennison. Touchdown, Miami.
It happened in the Orange Bowl, a night of glory for Bernie Kosar and the Miami Hurricanes. And now, the homecoming. In this his rookie season, Kosar hasn't taken the NFL by storm, and there are many better teams than the Browns. But they're both in the playoffs, set to face the mighty Dolphins.
Well, obviously, I'm looking forward to it. This is something, if you'd have drawn up this scenario a year or so ago, I really couldn't even have imagined. But I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be a challenge for our team to go down there and for myself personally.
What kind of reception do you expect? You're the enemy now.
That's been the hot question this week. I'm really not quite sure what to expect. They have very loyal fans down in Miami, and I really don't think they're going to change for one guy coming back to where he played college ball at.
No, this is strictly Dan Marino's turf now. Marino of the record 48 touchdown passes a year ago and the league leading 30 this year. And in this shootout, Dan Marino is the guy with the bigger guns. He and his gang are the overwhelming favorites. Once Marino and Kosar shared Miami's limelight. But now, in the context of the NFL, The town's just not big enough for both of them.
I'm not sure if you could really compare us, mainly because of the situation we have offensively with both teams. We're basically opposite offensive football teams. Their game centered around the pass, whereas our game is more of a control type game. And we've accomplished a good deal running the ball this year, but we still need to learn how to throw a little better. But the main thing is we're in the playoffs, and when you're in this league, that's the way I think quarterbacks are judged, by how to get your team into the playoffs.
If you guys were to win on Saturday, walk off that field with the victory, it'd be a big story, a big upset, no matter where the game took place. But in the Orange Bowl, would that be some special satisfaction for you?
I think at this level and at this stage of the game, being in the playoffs, that anywhere you win and any time you win in the playoffs, that's satisfaction enough.
Logic says Kozar and the Browns can't do it today. Still, there's something about returning to the scene of past glories, something that might get you believing the improbable can happen.
Kozar has set an Orange Bowl record for passing yardage, 300 yards for the freshman. In all probability, when the votes are in, a first ever national championship for the Hurricanes.
Marino and Kozar are good friends, by the way, and Kozar told me this week that he admires the way Marino has handled his fame in a low-key fashion. Kozar himself is a guy who shies away from the limelight. You might have been able to tell that by his demeanor in the interview. For his part, Marino says Kozar ought to just go out, relax, and have fun today. But then the Dolphin quarterback quickly adds, not too much fun. When the subject is fun in sports and keeping things in proper perspective, no one understood that better than the man the baseball world mourns today. Bill Veeck passed away on Thursday morning at the age of 71. His funeral is scheduled for today in Chicago. Why he's not in the Hall of Fame is a mystery to people who love and care about the game, and no one loved baseball more than Bill Veeck. No one understood better that it was the fans' game. What he coveted was to be associated with the fan, to have the guy in the street, the cab driver, say, yeah, Veeck is all right. He didn't care about what stuffed shirts and boardrooms thought about him. That's why for years he was the fans' owner, and a guy who enlivened the game with countless promotional stunts, the most famous of which was the time he sent a midget, 3'7" Eddie Goodell, wearing a fraction on his back, to bat for Veeck's hopeless St. Louis Browns in 1951 in a game against the Detroit Tigers. Years later, here's how Veeck remembered that incident.
It was just meant to be fun, you know. It wasn't meant to draw any people, because obviously only five people knew about it. But it was meant to illustrate sometimes that we take ourselves a little too seriously in baseball. It was kind of fun to stick a pin in some stuffed shirts and then stand aside so you get hit by the hot air.
Bill Veeck was a very literate, well-read man, a guy who could quote passages from great books and poetry off the top of his head. But in a way, I think it's appropriate that he's remembered for sending a midget up to bat in a major league game, because, as he put it himself, the thing I want people to remember about me is that I stood up for the little man.
He did, and I think every man would like to dream of the privilege of writing his own epitaph. Bill Veeck is one who did it when he wrote, every day is Mardi Gras and every fan's a king.
We'll be Dolphins offense. You think first of Dan Marino lighting up the skies with passes to the Marx brothers, Duper and Clayton. But according to Pete Axthelm, the veteran wide receiver Nat Moore deserves plenty of recognition too, both as a player and as a person.
Even if he chose to walk quietly away into a Miami sunset, as 34-year-old receivers are certainly entitled to do, Nat Moore would be worth a salute. He is a team leader, a presence in the community, a willing tutor of the younger and faster men who are replacing him. His warm, commanding personality alone would merit an honored place in the history of the Miami Dolphins and of pro football. But this season offers a bonus. Moore has taught the kids, the flashy Duper and Clayton, and they have amply repaid the teacher. A few years ago, Nat was removed on third downs. He was too old, too slow. Now he enters the game in the same situations. He's too wise and too creative to leave on the bench. Moore can see the irony in this. I was in the league about 8 years before I got single coverage, Nat told me the other day. Now the speedsters get the double coverage, and Moore picks apart the rest of the defense. To say that he is surgical and precise is accurate, but it is also a disservice. Number 89 is less a surgeon than a poet. Talk all you want about the way he spots creases in the zone. We who have watched Moore's career know that he celebrates a higher art form. He is an ode to the limitless possibilities of third and long, and of football and life itself.
I certainly think Nat Moore deserves that kind of serious tribute, Bob, but let's get to the more ridiculous. I have a wonderful obscure stat for this Dolphin game. Dolphins are 10.5-point favorite at home in the Orange Bowl. You know, 10 of the last 11 years, the home team has covered the point spread in the early Saturday playoff game on this weekend. What more could you ask? Take the Dolphins minus 10.5. Later today, the Rams are 2 points favored in Anaheim over the Cowboys. Except for the Bears, and the Cowboys are a very puzzling team this year, but except when the Bears blew them out, all their losses have come in letdown situations. I don't think they'll have a letdown today. I think they'll be looking for revenge against the Rams. I like the Cowboys plus 2. If you think I'm rushing through these picks, the reason is we have a new feature today, hate mail. A few weeks ago, I had some comments to make about the Giants, and I do want to mention that most Giant hate mail comes in the form of crayon block letters or people who send telegrams suggesting who hired me. Why would you spend
asked
the
around
money
here very frequently.
Why wouldn't you save this money for wagering on the Giants if you think of it? And here's my crayons.
Dear Axe, thanks for not picking the Giants the last 2 weeks. Now I can afford to buy a pen.
And we'll have more.
Quality material. We'll be back at halftime. Remember, Tom Cousineau, unable to make it. He won't start, that's for sure, and likely will not play at linebacker for the Browns, replaced by Scott Nicholas. Let's go to the Orange Bowl and pick up the introductions.
Side linebacker number 59, Bob Brzezinski. And left inside linebacker number 53, Jay Brophy.
Jay Brophy, a teammate of Bernie Kosar's at Miami. Very close friends. Kosar told me he's hoping they don't collide head-to-head today. Hugh Green, the former Tampa Bay Buccaneer, mid-season acquisition for the Dolphins.
At quarterback number 49, William Judson.
So the Dolphins introduce their defense to the fans of the Orange Bowl, a defense that at times has been suspect alongside their explosive offense. We'll see you at halftime. Cricky and
the National Broadcasting Company is proud to be the network of Super Bowl 20. Today, from the Orange Bowl in Miami, Florida, it's the AFC Divisional Playoff Game. The Cleveland Browns versus the Miami Dolphins. Brought to you by Mazda Cars and Trucks. The more you look, the more you like Mazda value. By GTE Sprint. When you call Sprint, you've got the future on the line. And by Coors and Coors Light. Beers with a difference worth tasting. Big game day in Miami. The Orange Bowl sold out again as the Dolphins come into this playoff game with Cleveland with 7 straight wins. Good afternoon, everyone. Don Cricky with Bob Trumpy on a perfect day in South Florida, warm and sunny, just like the Dolphins like it. As you know, beating Miami in the Orange Bowl takes an exceptional effort. The Chicago Bears couldn't do it. No team has this season, and Trump, the odds makers, don't think the Browns have much of a shot.
Well, Don, most people, when they play the Miami Dolphins, feel to beat the Dolphins, you got to keep the ball away from Dan Marino. Cleveland has that opportunity with a set of great running backs. These two, just the third set to combine for 1,000 yards each in a season. Interestingly, Pittsburgh had a pair in 76, Franco Harris and Rocky Blyer, they win the Super Bowl. Miami had a pair in 72, Mercury Morris and Larry Zonka, they win the Super Bowl. These two guys for Cleveland have 477 rushes by their running backs, accounted for 466.
The Miami success centers around a phenomenal passing game. Quarterback Dan Marino makes it happen fast. He again led the National Football League with 30 touchdown throws this season, and he's been going more and more, Trump, to a wily 12-year veteran, Nat Moore.
Yeah, Clayton and Duper get an awful lot of attention, but in this season, a season where Nat Moore almost retired, as Axe told you in the pregame show, on third down situations, Dan Marino is looking to that wily veteran. He's got 51 catches, 7 touchdowns, his most productive season for the Miami Dolphins, and this is where Cleveland's going to have problems. We know their cornerbacks are good in bump and run on the outside. How do they handle Nat Moore on the underneath coverage third down situations?
Dan Marino's only 24 years old, has already thrown almost 100 touchdown passes. His counterpart with Cleveland, Bernie Kosar, is a 21-year-old rookie. But Trump, they say him coming back to the Orange Bowl is like Br'er Rabbit back in the briar patch.
Yeah. And apparently the week in Vero Beach helped Bernie Kosar a great deal. They got a lot of work, a lot of good work, and he loves playing down here in this heat.
Well, he's got heat. 80 degrees at kickoff time. Sunny, partly sunny day right now as Marty Schottenheimer, after an 8-8 season and a divisional championship in the AFC Central, brings his highly trained Browns into this game. They worked hard, as you pointed out, Trump, and Vero Beach really felt that their team progressed greatly, particularly Kosar. He said he really came alive during the week.
Awful lot of weight on that young man's shoulders, too. He's the youngest quarterback in the NFL, playing where he became famous. Don Shula loves this place. They're 8-0 this season.
Have lost just once here in the last.